Right now, the Therapeutic Goods Administration has approved Moderna's COVID-19 vaccine for babies aged 6 months and up to the age of 5.
Well, to discuss this, we're joined by infectious diseases expert Professor Robert Boy in the studio. Professor, good to see you. A lot of people, parents have been waiting for this. Some parents are nervous about this. It is a significant development, though.
It is. It's a really good vaccine for at-risk children, children who have got disabilities, chronic medical problems, immunosuppression. Right. They need to be front of the queue because they could die from COVID. We've had a handful of deaths in young children already.
Asthma and things like that as well.
Asthma on the second rung, milder diseases, but still respiratory and lung diseases that increase your risk of COVID could best be prevented, could best be managed by being vaccinated.
Great.
So it still requires the approval of a TAGI. When do you realistically expect this to be available?
It's not just a TAGI, which will probably be fairly quick, but there's also getting supply from the United States.
And because so everyone's racing to get this to
They are, so it'll take 3 or 4 weeks.
Okay.
But it's something we ought to reassure people. This is a safe drug, right? Because there are a lot of people out there who think, well, I don't want to give something like this to my kids. We've had vaccine hesitancy for the last few years. We are very compliant in this country, but we want to stress that this is a potentially important thing for this next wave.
It is, and I'm not rushing to reassure people. What I say always is, let's look at the real-world evidence. Yep. And we've already got 500,000 children under 5 in the United States safely vaccinated.
Great.
We said the same with primary school children. Get the good experience and then proceed.
OK, let's talk masks here, Professor, because health officials are pushing for Australians to mask up indoors at the moment as this winter wave surges across the country. What would you say to people who are reluctant to put on a mask at this stage? Because mandates just aren't going to happen.
Well, masks are a pain, they're uncomfortable, but they're not that bad. I've got them in all of my pockets. I use them. They're really good in indoor settings where ventilation isn't so good, at work, in public transport, on aeroplanes. They work, but they need to be done as part of a multi-pronged approach. And part of that is if one person's wearing a mask, I'll wear it too. So you model for each other. You help each other to do the right thing. But then you also do the other things, social distancing, washing hands. It's only going to work if we pull together. And even if we reduce transmission by 20, 30%, we can get the pressure off the hospitals.
Yeah, that's the most important thing because hospitals and the staff there, they're just under so much pressure. And we want to do our best by them. So many people are saying, though, that this could be the worst wave we've experienced. Have we learnt from the past mistakes? I mean, no one wanted to talk about COVID for months. We thought we'd gotten through it. And here we are staring down the barrel of possibly the worst waves we've had.
We've learnt a lot, David, but we're still learning. This virus is changing, it's mutating. One of the things it's just done is mutated back to a couple of mutations ago. So it's turning back on itself and reinventing itself as like it used to be. So it could be that it's running out of options. So we are at risk right now. Thousands are dying in Australia in the last few months, compared with only 2,000 in 2 years. We need to act and we really need to redouble our efforts.
Always good to have your insights, Professor Robert Boy. Thanks for joining us this morning.
All right, well, the new medical advice is urging us to once again wear masks in the workplace and to work from home, and businesses, well, are feeling that impact.
They sure are. So the nation's chief medical officer, Professor Paul Kelly, joins us now from Canberra to try and sort out some of that angst that is out there right now. Professor, good morning to you. It is a bit like that at the moment, isn't
morning,
it? The new advice was not a mandate, but how strongly are you recommending it?
Very strongly, Carl. I made a decision a couple of weeks ago to start wearing a mask again because I saw what was coming. The key message today is that we can all contribute to decrease the spread of the virus, and that's the important thing over the next month or so. Mask work, particularly in indoor settings. In terms of the work from home, there's two elements to that. One is slowing the spread. The second one is actually helping businesses with their business continuity. A lot of people are going to get sick with this new virus, the new variant, the BA4 and particularly BA5 variant. It's much more infectious. And so we're talking to business groups about that, making sure that they can keep that absenteeism rate down. It will really help them in the coming month.
So, look, you know, it might help in that regard, but we had on to cafe owners Jackie and Darren Silverman. They've got a cafe in the Melbourne CBD. I mean, their heart just sunk when they heard this advice to work from home. It could mean the end of their business.
Yeah, and look, they've really done it tough over the last...
every single day now, so it's just getting quieter and quieter and quieter on the street. We're just hanging in there at this point, I guess. We don't know what's going to happen or where it's going to go.
So, sorry about that, Professor. Your response?
People like your segment there have done it really tough over the last couple of years. I really understand that. The reality is, though, we do know that decreasing mixing of people at this time is going to make a difference to slowing the spread, and that's the important thing. The main issue here is partly, of course, about protecting the most vulnerable in our community who are at higher risk of severe illness, but it's also about protecting our health system. Yesterday, we were rapidly approaching our peak in hospitalisations with COVID that we saw in January. And so by slowing the spread now, we will allow the health system to cope with that, and so that helps all of us. We all need to be able to access hospitals on occasions we have other illnesses. Mm.
The thing I want to say is this, and bear in mind, obviously I'm clearly not a medical professional, but we've been through it all. Our most vulnerable should be fully vaxxed. That means four and probably more in the future. So of course, they need to take those precautions. But for the rest of us who are fully vaxxed or part thereof, isn't it about just getting on with it?
So, firstly, on the fourth dose, congratulations to the 500,000 people that came forward and rolled up their sleeves last week to get their fourth dose. That was an amazing response to that increase in availability of fourth dose. So keep that going. Certainly, protecting the vulnerable, absolutely essential. But that other issue, which we saw in January, if you remember that, Carl, about large numbers of cases, absenteeism and so forth, and that pressure on the health system, that's a key component now. The health system's already very busy with winter viruses, flu and other things, and so any small amount of increase there is going to put further pressure on, and that's the part that we all need to take a part in, not just protecting the vulnerable.
I know, but I think there's a lot of people out there who've had the flu that was worse. Our kids have had terrible respiratory illnesses that I think were certainly worse than when they had COVID, speaking from a personal experience. And we're not taking those extra precautions against those things. I mean, has the horse bolted for you here a little bit?
Hey, look, I understand people want this over, but wishing it to be over is not going to make it over. And I think the key part of this in winter, you know, we've talked about it on this program before and other programs, that winter was going to be hard, and it's coming to fruition there. The flu rates are decreasing quite quickly in every state except for WA, where they're just starting with their flu season as well as this COVID surge. But the other states are looking much better in that regard. But that key message there, Carl, it's not just about vulnerable and more severe disease. It's actually about what this is doing to our frontline health workers at the moment.
Okay.
And we all have a stake in that, to making sure that our hospitals can cope. I'm sure they can.
Yeah.
And I'm sure we can do, through actions today, we can change what happens in the future.
All right. Thanks for that, Professor. Appreciate your time.
Thanks, Professor. Thank you. There's a sense of deja vu this morning with the nation's top doctor joining the growing chorus of leaders calling for Aussies to mask up and work from home. President of the Australian Medical Association, Dr. Omar Korsha, joins us now. Doctor, the Chief Health Officer stopped short of mandating the move. It feels like there's a growing momentum towards that, but do we need that to go that far?
Morning, Carl. What we have is yet another COVID crisis before us, with over 5,000 of our hospital beds taken up by people with COVID, thousands upon thousands of healthcare workers unable to attend work because they've got COVID or they've been exposed enough to it, they can't go to work. And what that means is that people who need hospitals simply cannot access the care they need. So we've got a choice as a community. We can either do the right thing and try and protect those hospitals, keep those resources available for the Australians who need it, or we can ignore it until our chief health officers have got no choice but to bring back mandates. So we all need to take a little bit of the bitter pill, do the right thing. That means going and getting your vaccines, even though they're not the complete solution, they're certainly part of it. It means if you have got the slightest cold or flu symptoms, to actually test yourself, to report those results to the government in the way you're supposed to, and not to be out and about if you've got cold and flu symptoms.
But
We
don't need the mandate.
Well,
though,
just say that in WA,
this is a personal responsibility thing. I mean, it's getting to the point now where a lot of people have had the flu that's worse than COVID.
Yeah, well, this is where governments, though, have a role to play. Yeah, we'll do the right thing, but, you know, we have seatbelt rules, we have speed limits, because we do need to make those expectations really clear to the community when it's critical to protect other people's health, and we're getting very close to that point now. Now, we're not at this stage calling for mandates, but if we get to that point, and it may well be the way the numbers are looking, that is coming, and if people aren't doing the right things, then there may be no choice but for the governments to step up and protect the community by asking us to do the right thing when it comes to masks, and only in indoor venues. We're not talking about lockdowns. We're not talking about 2020, 2021 here. We're talking about a new virus, a new situation, but it is one that cannot simply be ignored because it's not going away, Carl.
Are you saying that, say, for example, in indoor restaurants, pubs, that kind of thing, masks should be the go?
I'm saying that if you're in a crowded venue with lots of other people, then if you're not actively consuming beverages or food, then yeah, masks are recommended. That is the message from Paul Kelly yesterday, our Chief Medical Officer of the Commonwealth. It's also the message from several of the state governments, the state Chief Health Officers. The governments aren't willing to mandate it because they're worried about the blowback. They know Australians don't want mask mandates. But at the end of the day, they've got to step up and protect the community. And when that time comes, I expect them to do the right thing.
All right. Good to talk to you, Doctor. Appreciate your time today. Thank you.